Some of the more notable controversies surrounding the film are some edited remarks made by Arnold that he would like to be remembered like Jesus or dictators, most notably Hitler, for thousands of years. When contacted for a newspaper article in 1988, George Butler admitted that, during the filming of Pumping Iron, Arnold definitely said that he admired Hitler. Butler then conceded that the remark was cut from the final version of the film. Arnold's possible Nazi sympathies are well explored in Wendy Lee's damning autobiography that Arnold actively tried to have suppressed for years. Commenting on Arnold's past, she stated that he was once booed off stage for hitting a Nazi Sieg Heil salute in a posing exhibition in Germany, before furiously retorting, "These people are nothing without an Austrian to lead them." His image as the Aryan Uberman and his father's own Nazi Party past definitely invited the comparisons. Lee asserts, "Arnold didn't exactly downplay it, until it became conscious that this was a taboo and damaging association." Arnold was speculated to be a keen collector of Nazi paraphernalia at the time, and his support of fellow Austrian president, UN Secretary General Kurt Waldheim, who hid his former Nazi past, didn't exactly help disassociate himself from this negative snowballing image. A darker explanation as to why Arnold has never allowed that 100 plus hours of unseen footage to see the light involves Butler's proposal for a book he intended to release called The Master Plan in 1997. The book was to feature what went on behind the scenes during the making of Pumping Iron. Butler claimed it contained verbatim transcripts of material that weren't used in the film. The most explosive alleging Arnold's admiration for Hitler. In one deleted interview, Arnold was asked, "Who do you admire most?" Arnold had mentioned Hitler along with Jesus and Kennedy. Butler always maintained that Schwarzenegger was a flagrant, outspoken admirer of Hitler during filming. Not only Butler, but a number of Arnold's bodybuilding friends, including his co-writer of the biography, Education of a Bodybuilder, claims to have seen Arnold playing Nazi marching songs from long-playing records in his collection at home. More alarmingly, he frequently clicked his heels and pretended to be an SS officer. According to Arnold Kent Hall, the ghostwriter of his 1977 autobiography, he saw Arnold imitate Hitler for laughs, and even produced two photos of Arnold pulling his hair down over his forehead, using the comb as a Hitler moustache, and raising his arm in a mock Nazi salute. Quoting Hall, "To some people that's funny and to some people it's not." Arnold was anxious to keep that away from the public eye. The New York Times later asked Arnold for an explanation for Butler's claims, asserting that things could be cleared up simply by viewing the outtakes. But Arnold had very conveniently purchased all the footage from Butler in 1991 for $1.2 million. When the Times asked to view the footage, Arnold dodged the question. "I don't know where they are now, but I'll sure we have them," he said. "I've never held them in my hand." Rick Wayne, editor for Joe Weider and fellow bodybuilder, recounted, "I remember watching Arnold following Joe around the office one day making one anti-Semitic remark after another, telling awful Jewish jokes and pretending he was Hitler, doing the salute. Poor Joe was so upset that he was almost crying over it." Weider needn't have cried too hard over claimed racism, considering his infamous statements that black guys on covers don't sell muscle magazines. Rick Wayne expanded further. "It was no secret around the Weider headquarters that whenever the publisher featured a black champion on the cover of Muscle Builder, sales plummeted. Surely a champion who couldn't sell magazines was as close to useless as an endorser of food supplements and gym equipment," Rick explains. Dave Dupre, who also appeared in Pumping Iron, mentioned that while they were working out at Gold's Gym, Arnold told him, "Black people are inferior. You are not capable of achieving the success of white people. Black people are stupid." Dupre also claimed that he heard Arnold make a number of anti-Semitic remarks. "He would make fun of the Jews. If anybody looked Jewish, he would point it out and tell them they were inferior. I would remind him that it was a Jew who had brought him to America, and then he would shut up." The Jewish Weider brothers, however, knew how to put their business interests first and weren't about to sever associations with their popular cash cow. As part of Butler's 1991 agreement to sell the Pumping Iron footage and outtakes, Arnold's associate, Neil Nordlinger, was allowed to search Butler's extensive collection for any unflattering images. Nordlinger destroyed 43 images that Butler would never divulge the embarrassing contents of. In a bizarre twist, Butler later recounted his previous damning statements on the topic, saying that his transcribers may have had trouble getting down the correct wording because of Arnold's thick Austrian accent. With Butler's passing, we may never know the secrets contained within those transcripts. But Arnold's own words are telling. Talking directly to the Pumping Iron director, "I philosophize that only a few men are born to lead while the rest of humanity is born to follow." And from that, he went into discussing history's great conquerors and dictators. "We can't live without authority," he told the filmmakers, "because I feel that a certain amount of people were meant to control, and a large amount of the people, like 95%, we have to tell what to do and how to keep order. I feel if you want to create a strong nation and a strong country, you cannot let everybody be an individual. Then you have to tell people what to do. In Germany, there was a lot of unity. The German soldiers were the best, and with the police force and everything." Another famous scene involves Arnold metaphorically describing the sensation of the pump. No doubt inserted for its shock value and to establish the boyish persona of Arnold from the outset, it also establishes a crucial plot point designed to smash the stigma that bodybuilding was solely the pursuit of homosexuals. Unscripted and presented off the cuff, it's a humorlessly ad-libbed one-liner that serves the purpose of quickly and clearly establishing from the outset that the number one of the sport is most definitely not gay.
"I spent with him one night. I go downstairs and put us together in a room, you know, to help him for tomorrow's contest. And that night, he will never forget."
Bodybuilding was stigmatized as a fringe sport, a sport for freaks and the frustrated, but largely it was viewed as a bastion of homosexuals. This was perpetuated by the muscle magazines of the era. In the 1950s alone, over 100 different magazines existed to feature the male body to the full extent allowable by the law. They weren't a part of gay culture as much as they were gay culture. And Joe Weider recognised the profit potential by publishing a score of gay-oriented magazines throughout the 1970s, with titles such as Body Beautiful, Young Adonis, and Young Physique all catering to gay men. Bodybuilding is as much a mental endeavour as it is a physical one. And it is the mind, as Arnold relates, which takes the body to places it doesn't want to go. Arnold's mastery over his mind and his use of psychological warfare highlights this frequent motif in Pumping Iron. As many of the scenes show, Arnold is psychologically on another level in his interactions with the other competitors. He's battle-hardened and he's playing the game as the dominant reigning champ. He has the intelligence, street smarts, and mental fortitude in spades over his competition. And he plays these cards at any and every opportunity. Arnold's sometimes cruel treatment of others is insinuated in the film as harmless gamemanship. In what he regarded as just another competitive tactic, psyching out the competition is a display of Arnold's mental as well as physical superiority. It also establishes a clever duality, Arnold as both the hero and the villain. Back in Munich, Arnold enjoyed hazing the new and uninitiated in all manner of ways, from eating dog food as a nutrition secret, to teaching Americans new to his gym German obscenities disguised as local greetings. While many would dismiss these incidents as harmless pranks, it is indicative of character traits bordering on sociopathic, especially when Arnold was operating from a position of dominant power to begin with. Similarly, Arnold's friendships came under strain from some of his comments in the film. Franco was reportedly devastated by Arnold's comments that he, Franco, was a mere child, a child who would ask Arnold for advice. In a telling final scene on the airport bus, Arnold discusses coming to Lou's house for some cheesecake and apple strudel together, with the joking remark about being set up with Big Lou's sister. As author Wendy Lee astutely notes, the audience understands Arnold's final coup de grace. He isn't content with just screwing Lou. Lou's sister is next on his agenda. It's a character trait that compels Arnold throughout the movie. Not just content to win, he has to conquer and crush his enemies in totality. What's fascinating is the parallel storyline involving Mike Katz and Ken Waller, which foreshadows some of the scenes to unfold between Lou and Arnold. Due to Arnold's charisma and Katz's ability to articulate his struggle on the screen, the audience grows to hate Waller while simultaneously loving Arnold. A similar dynamic plays out in the future documentary Generation Ire, released 35 years later, which tries to imitate the Pumping Iron character dynamic but fails. It features the dominant champ Phil Heath, whose mindset is as equally as confident, smug, and arrogant as Arnold. But he lacks the same easygoing charisma that makes audiences warm to him in the same way as they do Arnold.
Hard work beats talent all the time. Well, that's what he's thinking. He thinks that hard work is going to beat talent.
If I go out into town with the missus, if I'm going out with the guys, I'm wearing button downs, you know, I'm wearing the same stuff. The guy would be like, how did you fit in that? And it's like, well, I got it tailored, bro.
There's a palpable joie de vivre about Arnold's personality that naturally warms people to him. He projects a dichotomy that intrigues people, because although he is as serious and unrelenting as a Terminator, he makes his quest look enjoyable and easy, pulling everyone into his personality vortex and making them feel good for being around him. The famous director Oliver Stone, who wrote the Conan the Barbarian script, said about Arnold, "Arnold was fun. Most importantly, he possessed that singular quality the movies worship. Charisma. It radiated from him with his ready smile and sense of humour. Strangers were drawn to him immediately. One Sunday, I went with him to Santa Monica Beach to hang out. We started as two sunbathers, and within an hour, I was surprised to see 20 people had already circled his towel with their own, like smaller planets around the sun. And within 2 hours, there must have been 50 or 60 fellow bathers all proud to join the orbit around the people's hero of Gold's Gym in Venice." What's even more startling is that as the audience, for all of Arnold's misdeeds and cruel bullying, we don't ever hate him for it. He's literally a smiling assassin in so many scenes, yet we as the audience can't help but smile along with him. We're guilty in our own self-identification as one of Arnold's willing accomplices. The location of the 1975 Mr. Olympia contest was held in Pretoria, South Africa. Many bodybuilders were surprised that the IFBB, whose official line was to condemn racism, was holding its most important event in the cradle of a state-enforced racist country. Yet Serge Nubre, the vice president of the IFBB at the time, had travelled to South Africa to spend a week as the Minister of Sport's guest to assess the racial implications of holding the Olympia there. After a week of being wined and dined in an all-expenses-paid tour in restaurants where apartheid restrictions had been suddenly lifted for his benefit, Nubre concluded that the 1975 Olympia should, indeed, be held in South Africa. Putting aside that the fact that South Africa had been banned from the Olympics due to its racist politics, and that it had donated several $100,000 to the IFBB's coffers, it seems the colour of money trumped the question of skin colour when it came to swaying Weider's final decision-making. Nevertheless, it made the landscape for many of the competing black bodybuilders difficult to navigate. Robbie Robinson was thrown out of a public park by a Pretoria policeman who was apparently unaware that apartheid had been suddenly suspended. As Robbie Robinson relates, "I had no idea what to expect in my mother continent under apartheid. My treatment in South Africa ranged from the extreme of being treated as a king with my choice of beautiful women, to almost being beaten for walking unaccompanied in Forger State Park. At times it was like being back in the South. I would be the only black in the restaurants and the gyms, and in many cases, it was obvious I was not welcome." Bill Grant spoke of the tense racial situation, recounting, "I was in South Africa in 1975 doing Pumping Iron, where there was a lot of apartheid going on. Arnold again stepped up to the plate. It was really weird. The bodybuilders got on the bus and they were told that the black guys could not get on the bus with the white guys. Arnold says, if these guys don't get on the bus, we don't get on the bus. We are all athletes. We're all friends and competitors together. We all ride on the same bus, or we don't get on at all." And that's the kind of guy that Arnold was. He stuck up for the other guys. Barely 6 months after South Africa hosted the IFBB Mr. Olympia, three heavily armed government battalions butchered 1,000 black South Africans on the streets of Soweto, southwest of Johannesburg, for daring to protest against the passbook law. Thanks again for watching this first video in a three-part series that delves into some curious and controversial backstory moments in the film Pumping Iron. Now, these videos aren't designed to be a hatchet job on bodybuilding or Arnold's reputation, but just instead air a simple recount of the things said and done that don't fit the carefully curated hagiography of Arnold's sometimes checkered past. If you like this kind of golden era content, maybe check out these two suggested videos and subscribe for future deep dive analysis. Thank you again.